just wanted to say a special shout out to our Coachco viewers. Merry Christmas and all the best for this Advent season. We wanted to thank you for watching NBBC's gathering times, and we hope you've enjoyed hearing some of the sermons that have been preached. We also wanted to give you an opportunity to participate because, as you know, each Sunday when I go out, I encourage people not just to hear about what God's Word says, but to practice it. And I want to give you three opportunities that you can practice and participate with NBBC this Christmas season. The first is this past summer, we sent a small group of missionaries to Bolivia who worked with some prison kids. And we're looking for 5,000 people to give $1 a month to help with this very needed project. It provides food for kids, it allows them to get good education and schooling, and it also deals with some of the trauma they've had because their parents are in prison and they have to be in the prison with their parents. Second, we are starting up missional communities all throughout Burlington. Right now we have a missional community in the Palmer area. We're starting one up in Tansley. If you're in Palmer or Tansley and would like to find out more about these gathered times, we would love to be able to tell you about it. We have potlucks, and really we're looking for ways we can improve our neighborhoods. Who would want to be part of that? And you can participate. So if you would email us at info@nbbbc, we will get back to you and tell you about how you can participate in that. And finally, we know a lot of people at this time of year give money to charities, and we're wondering if you would consider making NBBC one of those charities. It would help us to continue to bring the life and the love and the joy of the kingdom to Burlington through projects like our Bright Corner Ministry, which helps those of low income, our Kids Club, which is seeing lots of kids come and participate, our annual Fall Fair, and many other initiatives we do. If you'd like to help in that way, you can go online at nbbc.ca and give, or you can send a check to 1377 Walker's Line. The information's on the screen, or you can check our website. Thanks a lot. God bless you, and have a very Merry Christmas. Let's light a candle for peace, we pray. A Merry Christmas, it's Christmas Day. A Merry Christmas, it's Christmas.
Right now for all the children, they can't even contain their excitement. I had one student run in and say, I brought you your gift, it's a scarf and mittens. And I said, oh, thanks. That kind of defeats the purpose of it being wrapped. And I had another girl, she's really trying to figure out what to get me for Christmas, even though I don't really say I don't need anything. And she says, okay, do you have a waffle maker? I was like, yeah, I do actually. She goes, do you have a razor? And I said, yeah. She goes, but does it work? I was like, okay. So I pretty much look like a bum when I go to work, apparently. So here I am in a nicer sweater, and I shaved the beard a little bit this morning. Okay, actual announcements. This will be the last week for dropping off the shoeboxes filled with personal items for local distribution to those who are in need. Thank you to Don Beveridge for heading up this activity for us to participate in. For those who have come across an activity that you feel your NBBC family could participate in, we encourage you to fill out an activity form that is on the bulletin board in the foyer and hand that into the office. Christmas Eve is next week, ! We will have a morning gathering at 10 a.m. as usual and our annual candlelight service at 6 p.m. There are inviter cards on the Welcome Center and a Facebook event on our Facebook page that you can share with friends and family, and we look forward to seeing you all there. The last Sunday of every year, we let you do the preaching. It is our Testimony Sunday. Words fill our heads, but stories fill our hearts. If you can be thinking of ways that God has shown you his love, grace, or mercy this year, please feel free to share your story. Some stories will be difficult to share. Others are filled with excitement and praise. We invite you to consider how you might participate in our worship on Sunday, December 31st. If you are a creative type, please feel free to contact a staff, and we would love to help you creatively express your story. Praise team? I didn't prepare. I prepared stories.
Okay. I'm going to have the special music people come up with me. Well, if you're like Mark, you need peace. today. And if you're like me, you need peace. We're going to do an Advent candle lighting in a second, but this group up here have been practicing a song that's called Glory, Let There Be Peace. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace. Let me say it again. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace. How many have experienced peace this Christmas? Well, for our Advent candle today, what we want to do is not just talk and tell you about how the manger in the stable was chaotic that night, how Mary and Joseph went through a long time of travel and came to a place where there was no room for them. There was time for no peace for them, and yet they found a place. And the Prince of Peace was born that night. And in your world, perhaps you've traveled this year, and come to a place where you find no room, no place. May you know that the Prince of Peace was born so you might experience peace on earth. Typical at on November 11th Remembrance Day that we sing this song called Let There Be Peace on Earth. And I thought just before we sing this song together, just with the piano, I thought maybe we'd just take a moment to experience God's peace. So would you just be silent? Jesus said, "My peace I give to you. My peace I leave with you. Yeah." Paul the Apostle says, "Think on things that are noble, righteous and pure, excellent and praiseworthy. Think on these things, and the God of peace will be with you." Stand as we sing a couple of Christmas carols this morning. First one's Away in a Manger.
The little Lord Jesus.
Kids are going to be dismissed, and you can have a seat. Go on down to their Christmas gathering? We have one more song. It's a song that you might have heard of. And during this song, I'm going to ask if the ushers will come and take up our tithes and offerings for this gathering. I want to teach you the chorus so you can sing and make it sound beautiful. The chorus goes like this. Light of the world, light of the world, light of the world, you shine upon us. Can you try that? Light of the world, light of the world, light of the world, you shine upon us. Light of the world, perspective, the right thinking. He shines, doesn't he? The singing. Light of the world. All right, the song goes like this. Oh, Jesus, Son of God, full of grace and truth, the Father saved the world, so wonderful. Prophets search to find the glory we have seen revealed. You shone upon the earth, but who will understand? You came unto your own, but who will recognize? Your birth was prophesied. Glory we have seen, the one and only King.
yet you became flesh, living as one of us under the shadow of the cross. Where through the blood you shed, you have made peace again, peace for the world that God so loved. Light of the world.
Shining. That's what happens when he shines upon us. So good morning, my fellow neighborhood missionaries. 1 week today. Ha! I'm going to have to start shopping soon. What was it my wife said she wanted? So we are on week two of our Advent series, and as we consider the story of Christ's coming, we read what are perhaps some of the most common words in all of the Christmas stories. It's those words that the angels announce to the shepherds: glory to God on highest heaven, and on earth, peace to those on whom his favor rests. The announcement of peace on earth by the angels hasn't quite gone the way we had hoped. As we look back on 2017, we saw tensions mounting with North Korea and the threat of nuclear attack. The UN warned that the world is facing the biggest humanitarian crisis since World War II, with up to 20 million people at risk of starvation and famine in Yemen, Somalia, South Sudan, and Nigeria. A large-scale ransomware cyber attack took place and affected over 150 countries. A terrorist bombing attack at the Ariana Grande concert in Manchester, England, killed 22. A military operation targeting Rohingya Muslims in Myanmar that was cited as a textbook example of ethnic cleansing, according to the United States High Commission for Human Rights. Hurricane Harvey struck the United States as a Category 4 hurricane, causing catastrophic damage to the Houston metropolitan area. At least 90 deaths were recorded, and a total damage reached $198.6 billion, making Harvey the costliest natural disaster in United States history. The Caribbean and United States were again struck by Hurricane Irma, a Category 5 hurricane that is the strongest hurricane ever recorded in the Atlantic Basin outside the Caribbean and the Gulf of Mexico. The storm caused at least 134 deaths and at least $63 billion in damage. An earthquake of the magnitude 7.1 struck central Mexico, killing 369 people and leaving 1,000 more homeless. Hurricane Maria struck in similar areas, making a landfall of Dominican as a Category 5 hurricane and Puerto Rico as a Category 4, and caused another 94 deaths and damage estimated at $103 billion. 58 people were killed and 546 injured when Stephen Paddock opened fire on a crowd in Las Vegas, surpassing the 2016 Orlando nightclub shooting as the deadliest mass shooting perpetuated by a lone gunman in the United States history. A massive blast caused a truck bombing in Mogadishu, Somalia, killing at least 512 people and injuring another 316 others. A magnitude 7.3 earthquake struck the border between Iran and Iraq, leaving at least 530 dead and 70,000 homeless. A mosque attack in Sinai in Egypt killed 305 worshipers, leaving hundreds more wounded. All this and more taking place in this past year. Peace on earth? I suspect if we were to take time and ask each person here about their experience of 2017, I'm sure we'd have a very long list of events and hardships disturbing our peace, wreaking havoc in our hearts, troubling our minds with chaotic thoughts and concerns over which we worry and we struggle with. And to be honest, there are times when we just feel like saying, God, take me now. We long to be rescued from this world of heartache and pain. And when we hear the angels announce, we find ourselves cynically saying, peace on earth? This past winter, Sarah Fader, a 37-year-old social media consultant in Brooklyn, who has been generalized anxiety disorder, texted a friend in Oregon about an impending visit. And when a quick response failed to materialize, she posted on Twitter to her 16,000 followers, "I don't hear from a friend for a day. My thought, they don't want to be my friend anymore." She wrote, appending with the hashtag, what anxiety feels like. And thousands of people then soon offered up their own examples under that same hashtag. Some were retweeted more than 1,000 times. You might say that Mrs. Fader struck a nerve. "If you're a human being living in 2017 and you're not anxious," she said on a telephone call, "there's something wrong with you." A study from 2000 shows that since the 1950s, children are suffering far more anxiety than any other previous generation, leading some to call this the age of anxiety. In 2013, the Canadian Mental Health Association estimated that the total number of 12 to 19-year-olds at risk of depression is a staggering 3.2 million. One in 12 youth are dispensed with a mood or anxiety or antipsychotic medication. Peace on earth? Just as an aside, by the way, this rise of anxiety in children and youth is something that's so upsetting that we couldn't just stand by. And so in this new year, NBBC is moving towards a new counseling ministry that specializes in children with anxiety. You may or may not be aware that Sherry, our pastor of family and children's ministry, graduated from Tyndale and is now a registered psychotherapist specializing in children's mental health. You'll be hearing more about this as plans unroll, but we know that there is a very long waiting list for children even to see a counselor in Burlington, and so we thought this was an area we can step in and be part of the solution because we want to see people, and we want to be people who are instrumental to seeing peace on earth. But what if we envision peace on earth backwards in our heads? What if our expectation of peace on earth isn't so much the case of our outward world becoming peaceful and slowly taking over our hearts? What if it's about our inward world, our hearts becoming more peaceful, and slowly our peace overtaking the world? What if the angels were telling the shepherds and us that we can have peace even on this kind of earth? It wasn't only the angels who told of peace coming. Long before they announced the birth of Jesus, the prophet Isaiah painted a vision of peace on earth in one of his prophecies. But before we look at the text, I just want to think a little bit about what peace is. Peace is not something you can measure. There's no peace scale. It can't be bottled up and given to people. It can't be sprayed in a room full of relational tension. Can you imagine the sales at Christmas time if we could? Peace is spiritual. It's not a substance. It's non-material. And while it is certainly possible to fabricate the feelings of peace through medication to supply serotonin and other chemicals to stimulate a person's brain when they're crippled by fear and anxiety, and that's a good thing, there is certainly more to peace than this. When the Bible speaks about peace, it's speaking about the Hebrew word shalom. If I were to throw 1,000 threads onto a table, they wouldn't be a fabric, writes Timothy Keller. They'd just be threads lying on top of each other. Threads become a fabric when each one has been woven over and under and around through every other one. The more interdependent they are, the more beautiful they are. The more interwoven they are, the stronger and warmer they are. God made the world with billions of entities, but he didn't make them to be an aggregation. Rather, he made them to be a beautiful, harmonious, knitted, webbed, interdependent relationship with one another. And the biblical conception of shalom is universal flourishing, wholeness, and delight. And God created the world to be a fabric for everything to be woven together in interdependence. And when things are chaotic and peace is lacking, don't we tend to say things like the world is falling apart? To say people are divided? And when we lack peace in ourselves, we say things like, I'm coming undone, that the fabric of our peace is falling apart. Shalom, the peace that the Bible talks about, includes becoming whole and integrated. And this is the peace that the angels announced and that Isaiah talked about this peace when he describes it in this way. This is what Isaiah, son of Amos, saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. In the last days, the mountain of the Lord's temple will be established as the highest of the mountains. It will be exalted above the hills, and all nations will stream to it. Many peoples will come and say, "Let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the temple of the God of Jacob. He will teach us his ways, so that we may walk in his paths. The law will go out from Zion, the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He will judge between the nations and will settle disputes for many peoples. They will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not take up sword against nation, nor will they train for war anymore. Come, descendants of Jacob, let us walk in the light of the Lord." Isaiah's vision of what peace is going to look like is ultimately, this is what he envisions it's ultimately going to be when peace finally and fully comes, and when war ends and weapons are refashioned for good and nations don't even train for war. Can you imagine nations not even training for war? I'd like for us to take some time looking at this passage and considering what it might teach us about finding and growing and preserving peace in a world that seems so unpeaceful. And how I'd like to do this is by pulling out three principles that I see in the text. And it's as if there's this future vision of peace that we have been privileged to see, and we get to take hold of it and yank it and pull it into the present. That's what we're going to do this morning. We're going to take this peace that we long for, we're going to grab hold of it, and we're going to pull it into our present circumstances. I'm inviting you, in essence, to live out this future reality of peace here and now. That's what we get to do. So how is this vision of peace by Isaiah seen? How can we make it our reality? I'd like to suggest that from this text, we can find three steps, three principles to realizing this vision of shalom that Isaiah talks about. And you know, I gotta say, I know it's typical of pastors to have three steps to everything. I don't mean to simplify things and make it seem easy. These are not easy steps. They're really not simple. I know they're complicated, but I'm hoping they can be something we can grasp and we can meditate on and we can let sink and become more aware of, because living out this reality is so essential for our own health and for the health of our world, and it's sadly lacking. So let me just start with verse 3, where we read, "Come, let us go to the mountain of the Lord, to the temple of the God of Jacob. He will teach us his ways so that we may walk in his path." The beginning of peace starts by learning the ways of God. God wants to teach us so that we can walk in his path. This means that we need to become students of God's teachings. Now, we have a certain disadvantage in our day. When we hear the word student, for most of us, I imagine it conjures up pictures of a lecture, kind of like this, right? Where the teacher's up front and the students are in chairs and he's speaking and you're listening and maybe you're writing down the information, and later on you might be asked to write it back so that then we can say now you know it because you can write it. But that's not at all what it meant to be a student in ancient Israel. The teacher-student relationship would be more like an apprenticeship, a very intimate apprenticeship. The student was to imitate the teacher, to copy their behaviors and actions. Learning is not just head knowledge, it was life knowledge grounded in experience. And my fear is that for many of us, when we hear that we're to become students of God's word, what we envision is sitting around tables answering questions to a Bible study. This is not what it means to be a student of God's ways. Certainly that's important, that's a piece, but there's far more to it. In the territory of Nunavut, there's a small island called Igloolik. In the winter, the average temperature is minus 20 degrees below zero. And there's a thick sheet of ice that covers the surrounding waters, and the sun is rarely seen. And despite the brutal conditions, Inuit hunters have for some 4,000 years ventured out from their homes on the island and traveled across miles of ice and tundra in search for game. The hunters' ability to navigate vast stretches of the barren Arctic terrain, where landmarks are few and snow formation are in constant flux and trails disappear overnight, has amazed explorers and scientists for centuries. And the Inuit's extraordinary way of finding skills, wayfinding skills, are born not of technical prowess, but they didn't use maps and compasses, but they had a profound understanding of the winds and of snowdrift patterns and of animal behavior and of stars and of tides. But this unique talent that has distinguished this people for centuries is slowly beginning to evaporate as the Inuit culture is changing. The Iglulik hunters have begun to rely on computer-generated maps to get around, especially the younger Inuit members. The ease and convenience of GPS makes the traditional Inuit techniques seem archaic and cumbersome, so they're not being passed on. But as GPS devices have proliferated, reports of serious accidents during hunts have spread. A hunter who hasn't developed their wayfinding skills can easily become lost, and particularly if the GPS receiver fails. The routes plotted on satellite maps can also give hunters that tunnel vision. Have you ever heard somebody following a GPS and ending up where they shouldn't go, but the GPS told them to go that way? Well, just think if the ice isn't thick enough and it says, just go straight. And that's what's happening. A local anthropologist who has been studying for 15 years notes that there's this deterioration of their wayfinding abilities and a weakening feel for the land. And faith in Jesus is passed on in a very similar way to those ancient traditions. It's from person to person. We live it out before one another. The way that a young entrepreneur knows what it means to follow Jesus as an entrepreneur is to look back and to watch the life and to study those older entrepreneurs who are walking with Jesus, who in turn had watched their elders who were entrepreneurs following the ways of Jesus. And we pass these things on. We teach our kids how to pray, not by giving a book on prayer. We get at their beds and we say, let's bow your head and hold your hands. And I'll say the prayer you can repeat after me, dear Jesus, dear Jesus. And we teach by modeling, but it's participation in which they learn. We don't get discipled by programs and by apps, even though many churches are leaning towards us. We're discipled by Jesus in the context of relationships and community. We learn from one another as much as we do from any old book. See, I watch older couples. You don't know, I'm a people watcher. I watch older couples in this church and how they participate, engage, and interact. And I go, oh, look at that. Or I go, oh, look at that. You know, you learn the good and the bad. But this is how we learn. And Jesus longs to take us deeper into spiritual truth, but sometimes I wonder if we are like those Inuits whose way of life is slowly disappearing. We are not passing down the ancient truths that have guided how followers of Jesus have lived for centuries. And the first step towards the peace of God on earth is a profound education in the ways of imitating the life of the one who is discipling us. That doesn't just mean how he reads his Bible and how he says his prayers. It's how he lives his life. How did Jesus brush his teeth to glorify God? How did Jesus cook his meals to glorify God? How did Jesus run his business prior to being a wandering prophet and teacher? And how do we imitate his way of life, so that the generations coming up, we can pass on those truths to them? The second step is found in the line which says, they will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. May I suggest that this verse suggests that there must be a radical commitment to disarming for conflict. And it begins with a personal commitment to disarming. It's about letting go of resentments and anger and bitterness. It is a radical predisposition that will not harbor or entertain revenge. Easy peasy to say, not so much to do. Pastor Steve May tells the following story. He said this: earlier this week, a friend of mine said, "Last night I had a huge fight with my wife, and we're not speaking to one another, and it's all her fault." Obviously, this was a church. It wasn't Baptist. They don't fight in Baptist churches like this. I said, "My gosh, what did she do? Did she have an affair? Did she clean out your bank account? Did she become a Florida Gator fan?" He said, "No. We were supposed to meet for dinner together at the Olive Garden, and she showed up 25 minutes late and didn't even bother to call first." He says, "I'll give my friend credit here. I probably would have rounded up the number to 30 minutes. My friend continued, "She has no respect for my time. She thinks my entire life should be built around waiting for her." I said, "So when she finally showed up, how was the meal? How was your evening together?" He said, "It was terrible, of course. We fought and fought, and then we ate in silence." I said, "And the not speaking to one another, how is that working out?" Don't you hate pastors like that? He said, "I can't stand it when this happens. I hate it when we fight." I said, "Why is it necessary to fight over her being late?" He said, "I don't like being taken advantage of." I said, "Mike, your wife is late for everything. I don't think you should take it personally that she didn't make it to the Olive Garden on time last night." He said, "I just can't tolerate her excessive lateness." I said, "Not tolerating it isn't working very well, is it?" He admitted that it wasn't. I asked him, "Is a 25-minute delay in your schedule worth 2 or 3 days of marital misery?" He said, "No." I said, "Then let go of it." Friends, disarming for conflict means letting go of your right to be angry. I'm not saying you don't have a right to be angry. I'm saying let go of that right. Colossians 3:12 puts it this way: "Bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you." Did God forgive you when you asked for his forgiveness or before you asked? Before. Before. In Ephesians 4, Paul writes it in this way: "And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you." This kind of letting go is an act of the will. You choose it. It's a deliberate decision to let go of those things that tempt you towards being angry. Metaphorically, you are beating your sword into a plowshare and your spear into a pruning hook. Let it go. It's not worth the misery. The last step towards cultivating, nurturing, and preserving peace is found in the last verse. It says, "Come, descendants of Jacob, let us walk in the light of the Lord." Peace reigns when we begin to walk in God's presence. In other words, living consciously and conscientiously of the fact that God is present with you and he's present to you. John Ortberg tells the following story. "A few weeks ago when I was out surfing, there was no one else in the water except for a huge guy practicing martial arts on the beach. After I'd been out there a while, a tiny wisp of a kid came paddling up out of nowhere. I couldn't believe he was out there by himself. He pulled his little board right up to next to mine. He was so small, he hardly needed a board. He could have stood on the ocean on a frisbee. He told me his name was Shane. I asked him how long he'd been surfing. He asked me how long I've been surfing. I asked him how long he'd been surfing. He said 7 years. How old are you? I asked. 8. Then he said, "What I like about surfing is that it's so peaceful. You meet lots of nice people here." We talked a little longer, and then I asked him, "How did you get here, Shane?" "My dad brought me," he said. Then he turned around and waved at the nearly empty beach. The Goliath doing martial arts waved back. "Hi, son," he called out. Maybe it was, "Hi, son," I don't know. Then I knew why Shane was so at home in the ocean. It wasn't his size. It wasn't his skill. It was who was sitting on the beach. His father was always watching, and his father was very big. Shane wasn't really alone at all. Neither are we. You know, there are times when what I have to do to preserve my sanity is go into a room that has no lights, where there's no sound, if possible, and I have to be still, and I have to set my mind focused upon the fact that God is in this room with me. God is present to me. And when I can still, all, you know, that rushing around you're doing in your head prior to actually moving, all the thoughts that come crashing in and stuff that just, and all that crazy, I have to allow all of that to be tamed towards this one thought: Jesus is here with me right now. Jesus is present to me right now. The Prince of Peace is here with me right now. The God of love is present, and he's attentive to, he's watching, he is focused upon me right now. Sometimes I need that for my own sanity. I think you need it too sometimes. Friends, the fact that God is present with us, living each moment in confident awareness of this, is in part what it means to walk in the light of God. The peace in your hearts, get this, the peace in your hearts will follow the thoughts in your head. That's why I need to go and have my thoughts focus on Jesus. Do this little experiment. I want you all to think back to the last time you were worried or anxious or lacked peace. Just think back to that time. Now answer this question: what was your mind fixated on? What were you thinking about? Where were your thoughts dwelling over and over? And I can say with absolute confidence, you were not thinking about God and his perspective, were you? But that's what he wants. You weren't thinking at that time, oh, God is on the throne and he's reigning, were you? You weren't aware that my Father, who is great and mighty and sovereign, he's reigning. He's aware of my circumstance. He sees with me and he's for me and he's present to me, and I can be confident that he is with me and will get me through this. You weren't thinking those thoughts, were you? Sometimes the way that people have interpreted this ongoing presence of God in their life is to think that he's watching to catch us being bad, to nail us for our infractions. Like that police officer that's hiding just behind the overpass on Appleby line between Walmart and Canadian Tire. Kind of like that guy, you know. You come down the hill, picked up all that momentum going down the hill, and he nails you for doing 70 in a 60 zone. God is not like that policeman. He's there to catch us when we fall. God is there to cheer us when we're doing well. He's there to lean against when we're feeling weak. He's there to reassure us when we're afraid. And yes, he's also there to nudge us in the right direction. But the more we cultivate and acknowledge the presence of God in our day-to-day lives, the more we'll experience the peace that his presence brings. Friends, this radical vision of being whole and at peace can begin in us on earth and spread into our wider world, until one day the Prince of Peace will come back to this planet and he will restore all things finally and ultimately to himself. Until then, we can take hold of this future vision and we can pull it into the present, first by being students or apprentices, disciples of Jesus. Second, by this radical commitment to personally disarming ourselves of all conflict. And finally, to actively walk in the light of the Lord, beginning with a growing and ever more confident awareness that God is near to us. Any questions on peace on earth? Three steps. So simple. As we're listening about it, wait till you get out those doors. Let me pray for us. Lord Jesus, we want to be people who experience the presence and peace of God in the hardships of our lives. And we want to model it to those who are looking to us to train them in what it means to be disciples. And we want to model it to those who are watching us to see if God makes a difference in this world. And so remind us each moment of our day that you are present to us, that you are with us and you are for us. May we be students of your ways so that we might not walk in ways that take us from you. And may we, even now, pre-decide that we are going to let go of our anger and our right to get our own way for the sake of peace in our world, in our relationships, and in our hearts. And Lord, we ask these things that you might get glory. Come, Lord Jesus, with your peace and your presence in our hearts and to our world, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to suggest an exercise. It's not push-ups. I want to suggest that before you leave this place, not necessarily this room necessarily, because I know it gets a little noisy in here, but before you leave this place, leave with the presence of God's peace. That might mean that you have to find a room alone in the dark. By the way, the back hallway stairs, when it's back, it's really black. Just don't try walking. But remind yourself that God's peace and his presence is available to you today. And I know what it's like with a week before Christmas, and it's all the stuff that needs to get done, because I know, because I feel that tension inside of me. But if you can engage the presence and the peace of God, guess what? Your Christmas shopping will still get done. And you will not have the same amount of stress and anxiety in the process. And guess what? If you take your kids with you, they'll watch, and they might learn the presence of peace in shopping. And wouldn't that be a great way to teach your kids, in contrary to what you're presently teaching them, maybe? And friends, you can have the peace of God in your heart for those circumstances which you can't control and that make you so frustrated. You know the ones I'm talking about, don't you? The person sitting beside you might be that one. It might be the guy wanting to get that parking spot and zips in right before you and you can't control him. It might even be your own self that you can't control. But God's peace, his presence, control that. Go in the peace of God this day. Leave in the presence of the peace of God this day. Take time to embrace the peace of God this day, and then go out into your world.